Hello and welcome to this tutorial video that will cover some of the new features in the UKIE Country Kit for Civil 3D 2021. My name is Joe Wright and I have been responsible for the Country Kit since the 2019 release of Civil 3D. My initial goals were to ensure the quality of the kit and to follow up any discovered issues with prompt fixes. As we have moved forward, the Autodesk team have shrunk the time between Civil 3D release and Country Kit release. This helps you to get on board with new releases faster. Now, wherever possible, I have tried to ensure that the Country Kit specific standards are up to date and that you are given more tools and content for your needs year on year. This is all backed up with documentation readily accessible inside Civil 3D. So, you ready? You look ready. So first up, we have a number of new sub-assemblies, including updates to some old favourites like the Earthworks sub-assembly. These are all introduced with crispy, shiny new icons on the tool palettes. The way I see it, if you're going to design an assembly in Civil 3D, why not do it with some style? All these sub-assemblies have attached documentation, so you will have full confidence in how to use them. Now, the most powerful of the new sub-assemblies is the multi-curb offering. This not only contains the standard designations, but it also includes high containment and bus stop variations of curb geometry. All these have been designed with transitioning in mind. So moving between one variant and another is quite seamless. A lot of effort has also gone into what I call the little things. You know, the small improvements here and there that just make your day-to-day output smarter and more intuitive. So really, they aren't little things, they are big things. We have a couple of new code sets and band sets and lots of extra styles and labels. Most importantly, wherever the defaults weren't right for the job at hand, they've been changed to help you get it right first time. So, enjoy the little things. One thing that has changed massively over the years is how layers are used in Civil 3D. Currently, the layers, based on UniClass 2015, have been developing since their introduction in the 2018 release. This has led to some inconsistencies which have been updated. A new tool is now included with this year's kit that essentially is a shortcut to updating the layer system on older drawings. As well as updating the layer names, it will bring the object defaults into line and ensure the layer filters match. So, never taken a shortcut before? Well, this one takes the pain out of getting your drawings up to standard. Now, as you're all keenly aware, the old TD93 standard for link roads has been replaced with CD109. Whilst changes are minimal, they have been assimilated into this release, and wherever possible, I've added additional design checks. Also, and don't act like you're not impressed, we now have micro drainage pipe and network catalogues included, and the default catalogues now default to the UKIE variants and not the American ones. So from this point, this video should last about another 35 minutes. And the little Andy is saying it's time to rock and roll. So fasten your seatbelts, it's going to be an interesting ride. Let's start near Wakefield, just southeast of an area affectionately known, in Yorkshire anyway, as the Rhubarb Triangle. Here we can see a land reclamation scheme on the site of an old coal pit. First up, I have some LiDAR data, standard 5-metre grid, and you can see we have a new style specifically included to limit the overhead of using these large data sets. Simple contours in 2D, but a matched 5-metre gridded surface in 3D. Now I hope to run an instructional video later this year with a number of LiDAR tips and tricks. So keep your eyes out for that one. Shiny. This area here is going to be a fishing pond. I have a survey, a working design, and a final version. Let me bring in the final one onto more detailed contours and name it Pond to keep it simple. There we go. Now, to compare the two surfaces, I could use a simple polyline and take a quick profile. But for something more permanent, I will need an alignment. In this case, I'll call it S1. You can see in this box that we have a new alignment style called sectional and a new label style just for section lines. There you go. One of the little things. Time for a profile. We have two surfaces, so I don't want them styled the same. I'll change the pond style to a contrasting style. Voila. Let's look for some more little things. A new profile style to match the sectional alignment and a new band set. Compare two surfaces. Can you see it? Now, as with all the UKIE band sets, the second profile will always represent the existing levels. In this case, the LiDAR surface. Bing! A simple, effective surface comparison section. Nice. Okay, I'll delete those and move on. And I'll quickly get rid of the surface contours. So, for our purposes today, we're going to design this link road. Okay, the aerial photography has caught up, so I'll end up just using it as a basis for a similar horizontal design. First, we need alignment, this time drawn from scratch. Okay. Standard stuff. I'll assign it a design speed of 60 kilometers per hour. Notice the design criteria file now references CD109. Let's open up that document. Look here. If I'm happy with a super elevation of 5%, then this will allow a maximum radii of 255 meters, assuming we have transitions. Okay, I'll set the criteria to match. There we go. I'll come back to this tick box later. Fine. Now, let me draw a couple of straights and then think about the corner. I'll draw a curve with inward and outward transitions. Notice that the command line defaults to the minimum, but I can, if I choose, ignore the suggestion and put my own value in, say 200 meters. I'll respect the suggested transition lengths of 60.5 metres, and we'll talk about those in a minute or two. Done. As you can see, I have a warning. It tells me I have broken the rules. Let's get rid of the aerial imagery and fix this by changing the design speed. Again, referencing the document, a design speed of 50 means the minimum will be reduced to 180. So my radius is now within the limits and the warning is removed. Okay, I mentioned that I would revisit this checkbox. This design check set is basically this equation in CD109. It looks complicated, but we have it covered. So for Q equals 0.3, and let me do the maths here, nothing into nothing, carry the nothing. Anyhow, a transition length of anything greater than 45 will satisfy CD109 at a design speed of 50 kilometers per hour. I have also included additional CD109 design checks that cover this, as well as doubling up with the radius checks we talked about. So you can actually deselect the design criteria file if you prefer and simply use the new design checks because they now include radius as well as transition checks. In this case, we will continue using the old workflow, ticking both design criteria file and design checks. And as I suspected, our transitions do not report anything that need attention. Shiny. Now let's be bad guys. Let's break it. Notice the icon here slightly changed to bring up the panorama table, but it works just as before. I'll change the output transition curve to 15. There, it's broken. Notice it fails on the criteria file and the design set check for both Q values of 0.3 and 0.6. Let's knock it up a notch. In this case, it only fails on the criteria file. So maybe this will be acceptable as a relaxation. Otherwise, change the value to be above the lower limit. Done. Now, a few more of the little things. Let's add some additional alignment labels. Pop. Simple. Now, I only speak two languages, English and bad English. But as you can see, the terminologies here are correct. You will find this throughout. And the label styles prefix with UKIE will always use the appropriate British variations. Okay, let's bish bash bosh a vertical profile out. Nothing new here, not this juncture anyhow. And as is common workflow, we will now add a vertical design by creating a profile. I'll call it vert for simplicity and we'll add a design set check. Now, these are new and look, they match this section of CD109. They also include the minimum K values shown on the first table we referenced. I'll choose the single carriageway design check. Let's quickly draw in some straights and build in an unsuitable gradient. And I'll just skip to the end. Okay, we got a fail. Look at the tooltip. It broke every rule in the book. Let's change the gradient. Still failing. But this may be acceptable as a relaxation, as it only broke one rule. Let's change that grade again. Ideal. As I mentioned, the K value check is included alongside the gradient check. So if we reference the table once more, at 50 kilometers per hour, we have a minimum K crest of 10 and a minimum K sag of 9. So let's add a K value of 12 to the crest, pass, and a value of 7 to the sag, fail. We can fix this just like we did with the alignment, by modifying the table of the profile. There we go, 11 and 12, now well within the parameters for 50 kilometers per hour. Now let's look at changing the band sets. And the new stuff I'm going to show you here got some very positive feedback when I asked some colleagues to trial the template. Firstly, let's take you to Profile View Properties, to the Bands tab. And for those of you who don't know, this controls the data beneath the profile. Currently chainage, existing levels, and horizontal geometry. You will notice a new UKIE composite band style. But don't use this. Simply import the full set. Click here and choose UKIE composite band set. This will load in all the rows you need in one swift move. It's called a composite set because one row controls many of the others. So, for example, to change the sample geometry points, you only have one geometry box to play with. This saves you having to cycle through similar boxes for many rows. So, one does the work of many. Look at the description. Profile 1 needs to be the proposed ground. This is common throughout now. And being a composite set, you only need to change it in a couple of rows. Fantastic. Let's take a close look. It's a staggered band set with horizontal geometry in blue, vertical geometry in green. Very readable compared to what went before. Let's highlight the profile because we have a matching label set. Again, this set is best imported as a whole, and this will match the ordinates to the sample points on the bands, and it will also label the K values on the profile. Very nice. This is one of those little things which is actually quite a big thing. Now, considering the colour, let's examine the layers in this year's template. UniClass 2015 continues to be developed, and we have a handful of new layers to support the bridge workflows with InfraWorks. The layers controlling the bandset colours can be found under the Profiles filter group, and these can be easily changed to reflect your requirements. Let's make them brighter so they stand out more. There we go, a light blue, and we'll have a light green. Lovely. But these layers have changed significantly over recent releases, and ensuring we have a level playing field between new and old drawings is important. To this end, a new UKIE layer conversion tool is available inside the toolbox. But to use this, I'm going to change to an older scheme. Often you end up resurrecting older schemes that may have been shelved for one reason or another. And this drawing, originally done with Civil 3D 2018, shows a new small estate road linking to an existing carriageway. Typical section 278/38 work. Let's examine some of the entity properties. This alignment here, for example, is on a layer that looks like a UniClass variant, but it has its shortcomings. As you can see, it doesn't quite make the grade. Unfortunately, this was typical of drawings done using the UKIE 2018 template. Let's zoom into these assemblies down here. Again, the layer structure reflects assemblies created in previous versions of Civil 3D, and we would expect a more up-to-date classification for a working drawing. Let's take a look at the big guy. As you can see, these issues were not confined to just alignments and assemblies. We have layer inconsistencies throughout. Also, take a peek at the layer filters. Whilst you do need a keen eye, they do differ from those in 2021. I'll delete this sections group here, just to emphasise a point later on. Oh, and this no Civil 3D layers? It just never really worked. So in this case, it's pretty much redundant. But I'll leave that in place for now. An added complication for Civil 3D layering is the object defaults, which control the layers onto which new objects are placed. Again, as you can see in this old drawing, it contains multiple references to incorrect layer classifications. The good news here is that the fix is relatively easy. Simply right-click and execute the layer conversion tool. Up pops this box. As you can see, it defaults to the 2021 template as its goal. But this can be changed. All you need to do then is just select which properties you wish to bring across from the source drawing, and if you want to update those layer filters. Oh, and this checkbox here, that will remove any unneeded layer filters, like that no Civil 3D layers one I mentioned earlier. Then just press OK. Job done, and it didn't take very long. Look at the command line to see the results. Now, it doesn't actually remove any layers, so running purge afterwards is a good call. And hey, I could do that. Let's look at the results. Yep, that alignment layer is spot on. And yes, sir, That assembly layer is also spot on. Let's take a look at the big guy. Okay, there are a few Klingons, but on the whole, we've ended up with things pretty close to 2021. Even the layer filters have been refreshed. Look, the sections group has reappeared, and that redundant filter has also been deleted. Finally, looking at the object defaults here, gives us the confidence that anything else we now add to this drawing will be placed on the correct layer. Life is good. My wife's just offered me a cup of tea, and I said no thanks, because I think 12 is my limit. But now is a great time to press pause if you need a comfort break, because we are about halfway through. Meanwhile, back at our road design, I shall divide the screen up so we can play with some of the new sub-assemblies. Let's drop a new assembly here. There, X marks the spot. Okay, so using the tool palettes, I will activate the UKIE design tab and will place a new complex carriageway. I'll add 2.5 metres onto the default width so as to include a cycle lane, and I'll attach it to the anchor point. Firstly, you may notice some subtle changes to these code sets. You may also notice some, how can I say, less subtle changes. But don't panic. I'm sure you'll soon be comfortable with the new colour scheme. Firstly, we can add a step slope to this new subassembly. If required, even smoothed if necessary. Alternatively, you can add individual shifts to each course. Documentation is provided on the right click of the icon on the tool palette, and matching better formatted documentation is available elsewhere in PDF format. Now, the new lane marker subassembly allows you to add individual lanes. Here, I am purposefully attaching it to the crown of the carriageway. Notice a slope direction will override the chosen side. This can be changed to towards crown if the lane width is measured from the channel line, as we're doing here for the cycle lane. Now, there's no super elevation assigned to this lane marker. Instead, it assumes the slope will be taken from its parent subassembly. To demonstrate this, let me over-egg the pudding and change the slope of the carriageway to -12.5%. Disaster! The lane markings have remained at 2.5%. Now, to establish a link, visit the assembly properties sheets. Dig down to the child subassemblies and force the slope to match that of the parent. In the first case, I'm going to use slope from crown, and in the second case, I'm going to use slope from lane end. See? These lanes will now match the slope of the carriageway. Well, now, I did mention there were some subtle changes to the display codes. Look at the channel line point. It's got red on it. This indicates that a code name has been assigned to the point. Maybe I want to assign another code name to other points. Let's check the documentation. Maybe I want codes on the points that mark the formation level. So according to the document, that would be CCP4 for the inside point and CCP3 for the outside point, shown here and here. So back at the properties sheets, all I need to do is find the values and assign them each a code. In this case, I'll use cap form end and cap form middle. Notice the code values change the anchor point colour, so you know values are assigned. Enjoy the little things. Let's check out this new verge subassembly. I will insert it to begin with as a basic verge. This will pretty much behave as shown, and unless targeted will remain static. Now, if you change the type from basic to various cut fill, it will give you the option to add a low point to represent a filter drain. With this type of verge, the slope will change dependent upon being in either cut or fill, respecting the slope variables declared for either state. I'll choose to always add a filter drain point, so if the assembly moves in and out of cut, the drain line will be maintained. Next, we'll include an earthwork subassembly. This is new, but pretty close to the old one, with the main exception that the codes have been exposed and the formation link has been preset to formation as well as datum. I will also add another carriageway to the left of the crown and change its width to 3.65. Now, on to curb provision. Whilst we have the new multi-curb subassembly, the old ones remain current. Anything that's in the process of being depreciated will be moved down into this legacy section. In the end, I'm hoping that the assemblies listed down here are a little bit like sandwich toasters. You know, you just forget you've got them. But back to the multi-curve. Let's anchor one to the channel line. In its simplest form, you have multiple designations to choose. Notice the new ones. Treif, high containment curves, and Castle, bus stop curves. We'll choose a high containment curve for this example, and we'll revisit the details of this subassembly later and move on now by adding some earthworks at the corner, like so. Okay, let's make a corridor. I sense you knew this bit was going to happen. Standard stuff. The new code sets look quite good when displayed in 3D realistic mode, and in 2D the lane markers display quite well too. Thinking of the lane markers, I want to show you how these transition. Let's say at change 300 I want the cycle lane to peter out and the road lane to take up the slack. So I select the cycle lane, knock its end width down to zero and tell it to start transitioning at change 300 and end at say 320. I just need to do the same for the middle lane, except I'm going to increase its size over the same region. A quick rebuild of the corridor, and Bob's your uncle, Fanny's your aunt. You have a lane transition between 300 and 320 change markers. Let's extract some feature lines. But I did forget to add the code names to the formation points of the capping course of the left-hand lane. I can tell that because the anchor point isn't red. It's easy to spot, easy to fix. Open the property sheets and change the code to, as before, cap form end. And look, it's got red on it. Great. Export for construction has been around for a while. The legacy variant remains in situ if you need it. It used a floating modeless dialog box, which sometimes, for no rhyme or reason, formats really badly. The new export for construction adopts a fixed dialog box and has other benefits. For example, you can include feature lines in the export that are not assigned to a corridor. Let's choose the feature lines created from the points we labelled, those, and the daylight. Another improvement is the progress bar has been moved down to the status bar instead of locking up the dialog box. There we go. Exported as polylines, ready to be sent to the contractor. The new export for construction also remembers the options you selected on a drawing-to-drawing basis, meaning it's easy to control exported revisions. Look, everything as before, and no clicks. More subtle changes, and you may have already spotted this, but anything with a formation link code is displayed with a red line. Look. Here, here, and here. So when it comes to making a formation service, what you are going to get is easy to judge. It also helps explain this overhang correction selection. In this case, selecting the bottom links will prioritize the links towards the bottom of this assembly rather than those above. There we go. A surface at formation level. Let's have a peek in 3D. Shiny. Okay, standard workflow again. Let's add some sample lines. Notice the defaults are now set to the existing ground style. Hey, that took a fair bit of fixing, to be fair, so making sure I'm pointing that one out. And now we have a formation surface style. Ooh, I'll just populate some regular intervals and voila, sample lines. I also fixed a minor issue that didn't update the chainage when you moved a sample line. There, that works now. Now we have the sample lines, it's time to create multiple section views. Again, this is pretty standard workflow, but the defaults here have been improved to encourage good practice and get good tidy sections. Notice that the label styles here now default to no labels. It's simple, but it prevents a mess of ordinate lines on the sections. Just add the ordinates that you need, in this case to the formation surface. Also, we have a new composite band set, similar to the one we saw earlier. Just don't forget to set the second surface to the existing ground. And as it's a composite band set, you only really need to set this top one. But I just can't help it, I have to fill them all in. And there we go, nice, clean, crispy, readable, staggered bands. And it looks even better if you change the annotation scale. And look, check out how the new verge behaved. Yep, in cut it slopes one way, and in fill it slopes the other. To bring this all into context, take a look at the old default 2018 section sets. Whilst I realise these old section sets were never acceptable, you can see the efforts that have been made to change the user experience here. Okay, let's go back to the Wakefield project. And just before I move on, you know, I do think these composite sections look great even at the default annotation scale. Okay, time to review the changes in pipe networks. Firstly, the default pipe and structure catalogues are now set to the UK variants. Yay! Again, this simple default did take a lot of fixing, but it has thrown a few people off track in the past, so I'm sure the result is worth the effort. And what this means to you is that the sewers for adoption parts lists just work straight out of the box. These were introduced in the previous release and support a comprehensive range of manholes straight from the SFA7 booklet. The references you see in brackets refer directly to the part figure references in the manual. My video that covered the new features for the Civil 3D 2020 Country Kit contains a really good overview of this parts list and the supporting tools available to get the best out of the Sewers for Adoption catalogue. So if you haven't seen that video yet, I would suggest you hunt it down. Of course, all these parts are in glorious 3D and can be manipulated in profile as well as plan. Now, the eagle-eyed among you will have noticed a new tool palette in this year's Country Kit. The Micro Drainage tool palette contains a number of basic sub-assemblies supplied by the Micro Drainage people. There is also a link to some documentation taking you through the process of using the parts catalogue that they have also supplied. In a nutshell, you simply need to change the parts catalogues to the Micro Drainage variants. This will then enable you to use the Micro Drainage catalogue parts list to create your pipe network. Now, this contains a number of basic manholes and a large list of pipe designations. Of course, if you are using Micro Drainage, it is also recommended that you also download the Autodesk Micro Drainage utility, which is an add-in that you need to download from the Autodesk subscription center. So, we'll move on. Let me bring in a basic alignment with a pre-drawn vertical profile to represent the crown of a road. Next, we're going to be looking at the multi-curb subassembly in detail. So I'll also bring in an offset alignment with an offset profile that represents the back of a pavement edge. Now, this don't look like no expressway to me, but it represents a basic set of geometry to explain the principles of curb transitions. I will isolate these objects to focus in on this geometry. Now, what we're going to do here is create curb transitions at given chainages. Let's work out what we want first. Let's imagine it's a simple drop curb that begins to drop at chainage 20 here. Has a couple of transition blocks, so it becomes a bullnose here at 21.8. It then remains static until 27.1, and it finally transitions back to a half batter at 28.9. Let's keep this little diagram on hand so we don't lose sight of the goal. Okay, we're going to need an assembly. X marks the spot. Let's quickly attach a 3.65 metre carriageway and snap one of the new multi-curb sub-assemblies on the end of it. In this case, I'll choose a castle bus stop curve. First thing to notice about this little baby is its insertion point. Look, it is not at the edge of the block, it's here. This is called a ghosted insertion point. This means something. This is important. Watch, I can switch the ghost on or off. But having it switched on, for bus stops particularly, is probably what you want. At this stage, let me introduce custom curb sizes. If you choose a custom curb, then the sizes here come into play. The geometry offered up will now be dependent upon your choice of curb family. Standard, high containment, or bus stop. In this case, I will make a custom bus stop curve, emphasised in width and height to help visualise the process of transitioning. To finish off the assembly, I will add a pavement, and as this will target the edge of pavement geometry I brought in, I will assign it with no slope and give it a width of 1 metre. I usually always do this because if I forget to assign targets, then this item will stand out like a sore thumb as it's flat and small. Okay, time for a corridor. Let's drop it in and see what we've got. It's probably worth splitting the screen up so as to save a lot of unnecessary zooming and panning. This window here for the assembly and this one here zoomed in around our proposed transition area. And you'll know when you see it, because the transitions will appear in this window. Okay, looking at the corridor, I still have to target the pavement edge. This line should be on top of this line. It's simple, go to edit targets and force that flat 1 metre pavement to extend to the pavement edge and change its slope to follow the vertical profile. There, look, perfectly targeted. I'll just swap this designation of the curve to HB1, so you can now see how the corridor is updated. I might as well zoom in a bit further here too. There, that should do it, showing the ticks at 20, 30 and 40 metre chainages. Now it's time to create the transition. Pretty simple stuff. At 20 metres I want to start the change to my custom bus stop. And at 27.1 metres, I want to transition back to the HB1. Half batter, batter, swing batter. Done. Ah, not quite. Nothing seems to have happened. Let's look in 3D. Nothing. But there is an explanation for this, you know, and I've got it. Kernel mustard in the library with a wrench. Actually, it's the frequency of the corridor, currently set to every 20 metres. So if our transition starts at 20 metres and reverts at 28.9, then the corridor just simply will not register the change. All we need to do to fix this is to add additional sections. We can do this on the ribbon here. One at 21.8, one at 27.1 and one at 28.9. Done. Rebuild the corridor and we have our first transition. Half batter to bus stop and back again. Here, looking 2D. And it doesn't look half bad in 3D either. Now, these additional section points can be managed in the corridor properties sheet here, under the frequency of the region. You know, just in case you typed in the wrong numbers. Whilst we're here, we may as well add a surface using the link codes from the pavement and curve. And we may as well use these feature lines here to ensure our transition looks smooth. It'll automatically rebuild the corridor. Look, shiny. Now, life is good. We are all set up for whatever transition we choose. Let's play. It's all controlled from the subassembly. Let's change it to transition to a tree high containment curve. Rebuild. Done. Magnificent. And we don't have to be flashy. A simple transition down to a bullnose was the original plan. So middle one, a BN1. Perfect. Okay, I suppose we can also go for gold. We'll start with a high containment curve, move it to a bullnose, and then to our custom bus stop. Click, click, click. Fantastic. Now, as you can see, this multi-curb subassembly is pretty powerful. And I encourage you to read the documentation. I am hoping to publish another video as summer approaches with more hints and tips on how to use this subassembly. So keep your eyes peeled, or maybe just subscribe to this YouTube channel. So, to finish off, last slide, almost done. The UKIE Country Kit includes new subassemblies, including the multi-curb one you've just seen. There are now composite, well-designed band sets. There's a tool to update the layers in older drawings. There are new code sets and lots of extra styles and labels, as well as micro-drainage catalogues, and the CD109 standard is now integrated. I really hope you have got what you wanted out of this video. My name is Joe Wright, and I'll be back with more videos later in the year.